accepting these loans. And that's all I need to get down on my knees and be thankful for all that he's done. For my mama, for my friends, for your love that never ends, for the songs that make us dance on this old dirt floor. For my babies, for my girls, for the way they changed my world. Waking up today, yeah, I just gotta say,
times, for lighting the way in the dark times, for pulling me in, for giving again, the times that I took it too far. I gotta thank you for keeping me humble, for picking me up when I stumble, and although I change, you stay the same, and I don't say thank you enough. For my mama, for my friends, for your love that never ends, for the songs that make us dance on this old dirt floor.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise up, eyes closed. One thing I know. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Good morning. Good to see you here this morning. And if you're watching online, we're glad that you're joining us as well. I think there may be a class or two that's not in here yet, but we're inviting you to praise and worship together with us this morning. So if you feel comfortable standing this morning for that, we'll begin praising God in song together.
For the beauty of the earth, for the
Yes, sir.
like the mighty mountain. Your justice flows like the ocean's tide. And I will lift my high voice to worship you, my King. And I will find my strength in the shadow of your wing. Your love, O Lord, reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness stretches to the Thank you for your faithfulness. God, we praise you for what you're doing in our lives and how you're working, God, how you're changing us to be more like you. God, we trust your promise of restoring us to right relationships with you and with other people. We trust your promise of making things new. We love you so much, and we give you praise and honor today, Jesus. It's in your holy name we pray. Amen.
I've heard you can take what's broken and make it whole again. Well, here's the pieces of my heart. What can you do? Them, 'cause I can't hold them all together anymore. So I let them fall, surrendered to the floor. You make all things new. You make all things new. God of mercy and love, do what only you can do, and make all things new. Only you can bring such beauty from the depths of all my pain. Only you can take this shattered heart and make it beat again. Oh, you hold us all together in your hands. I surrender all I have and all I
Trying to free our minds to some degree is being together, experiencing song that is in praise to Him, and also teaching one another at the same time as we sing these with each other. It's difficult at times to lay aside the things that may be going on around us, to lay aside the tragedy, the hurt, the sickness, and God knowing us because He's designed us, God knowing us because He's made us with emotion and not just intellect. And even with that, while those things that happen in life and just experiencing life together can be a distraction, but at the same time, how can we forget it? And maybe that's what this moment is for, as we remember Jesus. That above and beyond all things, He came to save us. So that maybe the knowledge of all the things that we just deal with in life isn't a bad thing to bring to this moment, knowing that He's the deliverer. Not only for those things that happen to us from outside sources, but even from what's happened within us when we have sinned. That he came anyway. And not just anyway, but for that very purpose. So he died on a cross. It's that death that we remember together as we take of his body and his blood, the bread, the fruit of the vine. So as we do this together, as much as we know that we're together in this world that we live in, we're together in the blood of Jesus Christ. We're together in that sacrifice. Therefore, we're together in that new life. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for Jesus and his willingness, Father, to submit to your will. Father, we thank you for his life, and we thank you for his death. Father, we are so glad that the resurrection came. Father, that we have a reason for doing this to remember that sacrifice. Father, as we do this together, we pray that you bless it. Bless each one that is a part of it. Bless us as a family together as we commune with it. It's in Jesus' name that we ask these things. Amen. Good morning again. It is good to see everybody who's here and also to have people joining us, I know, online. And so we want to take this time, as we usually do, to share also in maybe some praises together, maybe some prayer requests, things that we want to lift up together in our hearts to God. I'll share this. This comes from Art Piney. And he writes, "Dear church family, thank you for all the prayers sent up on my behalf. I can tell that they are working. My health isn't where it needs to be, but God has a plan, and he must have something in mind for me to do. Otherwise, his will would have already happened. My body strength is fine. I just need to get my lungs working better." So this is from Art. Let's keep him in our prayers, definitely, as he's still holding his own and hopefully continuing to make some progress with this. Others that we have this morning we need to mention. Yes, over here. While you're on the way over, I'd like to ask you to keep my stepsister, Johnny, in your prayers.
Hello. I have just a short little testimony / praise. I think it's important to share our testimonies with a congregation, and I've been coming here for a couple months, so you guys are my congregation right now. So thank God for you guys. While I was in prison, there was a man put in my cell who should never have been there. He was a murderer. He did 21 years. He had got out of prison. He caught two more murders. and then was put into back into prison. And he was put into my cell. This man had devil horns tatted on his head and the image of the beast on one arm and the name of Satan on the other one. God did most of the work, but I ended up leading him to Jesus. And he started reading the Bible every day while I was in the cell with him. I was in a cell with him for about a month. I was terrified, I ain't gonna lie, but you know, I was doing the good work and doing what I thought I was supposed to do, you know, leading him to Jesus. And I think the best part about that was, you know, how excited he got about how good his mom was gonna feel, because his mom was a Christian, and how good his mom was gonna feel that he, you know, changed his life and started reading the Bible and stuff. So I just wanna praise God for that. And if you guys would, just, you know, keep him in your prayers too, because he, you know, he's new Christian. His name's David Brown. Okay. Thank you, guys. God bless.
All right. Thank you for sharing that. Others? Back here, Neil.
As many of you know, we have grandsons that live in Washington, Missouri, near St. Louis, and they're in school up there. And the four-year-old got sent home this week for COVID exposure. And we're asking for prayers for him and his family, because Jennifer is a teacher up there, and she's trying to get things done in a new classroom and everything. So asking for prayers for him, because his prayer to his mommy the other day was, "Mommy, can you help my sadness by making me some cookies?" So just keep them in your prayers up there as they fight the COVID epidemic up in that area.
Okay. Cookies always help. Others? Yes, right back here, Jerry.
I'd like to ask for prayers for my sister, Karen. She was hospitalized Friday. She's got some breathing issues. It's not COVID. They thought it might have been a blood clot. They're not sure about that. They've run other tests, and she's scheduled for an echocardiogram on Tuesday. The only reason that late is they're very shorthanded at the facility she's at, so I'd like to ask for prayers for my sister, Karen, and also for the doctors and nurses that are attending, not just her, but everyone all over, because they're very extremely shorthanded. Also, I'd like to ask for prayers for my nephew, Justin, and his wife, Rosanna. They're going through some difficult times right now.
Okay, all right. John has some.
I've got a couple. Philip is online, said both he and Bria are feeling fine and doing good and they're strong. So I guess Philip's feeling a little better. Debbie Carter said Bill got a good report on his heart from his heart doctor, which is a praise. And then I've got several weeks ago we did it says Debbie is having cataracts removed Tuesday, just popped up. And then a couple of weeks ago, we did a love offering for Bert, and he sent a message thanking, I'll read it real quick, said, "Although it's been many years since we've been at Parkview, the bonds that we formed there were strong and have remained true and strong. Always we think of PCC as home, knowing we can always count on your prayers. We look forward to returning to the ministry. This time we will do it on wheels. We choose to count our blessings, learning a better way of doing things as we face every new challenge. As we are truly humble and grateful and willing and will continue to work daily, excited to see the forms of our ministry will take in this time. We can never say thank you enough." And that's from Bert and Diane.
All right.
And then Terry's got one.
I would echo Art's comment about thanks for the prayers and for the cards, and that you all remember me during my isolation for a little while. So I appreciate that, and it's great to be back in the house of the Lord with the brothers and sisters.
Okay, Good to have you back too, Terry. Any others? All right, let's pray. Father, thank you so much for blessing us and always providing the things that we need, not just physically, but even especially spiritually. Father, in all these things that we've shared together this morning, as our hearts lift those up to you, Father, we praise you, thanking you, and laying petitions before you, Father, seeking your provision for those that have needs, wellness and healing for those that need it. Father, praises for those that have had good reports and doing better. Father, we just continue to lift these folks up to you who need care, and Father, who need healing. Father, we're thankful for your Son, Jesus, that makes it possible for us to come before your throne in this way. And Father, we only come with confidence in what he has done and with his blood. Father, knowing that we within ourselves would not be worthy in any way, yet knowing, Father, that through his sacrifice, we're made clean. And Father, we in no way want to take that for granted, but Father, want to praise you and thank you for it. And Father, we pray that as we look into your word this morning, Father, that it will be beneficial to us in ways that we make application, not for our own selves, but also for others, in ways that we may be able to explain or encourage or build up, and maybe simply to teach for those that may not be aware. Father, we pray that you utilize us in every way to be that light, Father, that is ultimately yours, and that people will see that and they will glorify you because of it. Father, we thank you and we praise you in the name of Jesus, your Son. Amen. In Psalm 50, there's a familiar passage, and if I were if I had $1 million, what would you do with $1 million? Automatically, your mind starts to wander a little bit, right? In verse 10, for every animal of the forest is mine, the cattle on 1,000 hills. I know every bird of the mountains and the creatures of the field are mine. $1 million is nothing. When we consider God and who he is, and I have a few verses for us to look at. But, you know, when we think about, you know, what would we do with this? And I guess maybe my mind goes to that. Is anybody else watching any of the TV shows where you can win $1 million? Any hands? No? No. What's, Redonna, what's the one we've been watching? One was America's Got Talent. Yeah, America's Got Talent. You know, they ask people, what would you do if you win? Because, you know, they get to go to and have an act at Vegas, and they get to win $1 million. And, you know, it's everything from a little boy, what he would do with $1 million, and then to adults and what they would do. And some of them have answers. Some of them don't really have answers for that. They're not sure. But it's interesting, as we consider the comparison of what we would consider a lot to who God is and what he has. You know, we are somewhat familiar with the verse that God won't place more upon us than what we're able to handle, you know, coming from Romans. And a lot of times we think of adversities and things like that. I think that's probably the reason I don't have $1 million. in Haggai chapter 2 and verse 8, and I won't turn to all of these, but it says, the silver is mine, the gold is mine, says the Lord of hosts. Is there anything that doesn't belong to him? Deuteronomy chapter 10 and verse 14, indeed, heaven and the highest heavens belong to the Lord your God, also the earth with all that is in it. And anything that we could place our hands on, anything that we can even imagine, maybe we can't get near it. You know, I remember as a kid, everybody always talked about the gold in Fort where? Fort Knox, right? You know, we can't go see it, but we kind of believe that it's there, right? Because we're told that it's there. But it all belongs to God. It's all his. Shouldn't that in some way change our perspective of how we view life and how we view how we're going to choose to live life? If our Father owns everything, it's interesting, though, as we consider the cattle on a thousand hills, and it's a metaphor. I mean, is there a limit to a thousand hills? No. It's all his. As we consider the highest heavens, everything that is created, it's his. As we consider then, even Ezekiel 18, verse 4, behold, all souls are mine. The soul of the Father as well as the soul of the Son is mine. We belong to him. A lot of times we read these Old Testament passages and we think of God, thinking of God the Father. I know as we view passages like John chapter 1, when he talks about, you know, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. There wasn't anything created that was not created by him. And so when we consider creation, when we consider the ownership that is there of all of these things, everything that is created. Also in Colossians chapter 1 then, in verse 16, and actually let's start in verse 15, he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For everything was created by him in heaven and on earth, the visible and the invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and by him all things hold together. And this is speaking of Jesus. When he was walking around and talking to people and eating with people, when they were disagreeing with him or testing him with questions, was there the recognition that he owned it all anyway? Of who they were truly speaking to, the Creator. For us, on a daily basis, in life, as we encounter things, who has saved you from your sin? Jesus, right? Who is with you always, even to the end of the world? Jesus. There's a personal nature to the relationship that he has developed for us. If I were to put a title on this lesson, and John usually wants one, for this reason, because I'm going to ask a question, I would probably put the title, how much would you pay a thief? How much would you pay a thief? If you got home today and you discovered that your house had been broken into, is there anything that you can think of inside your house that you would be willing to pay that thief for if you could have it back? Let's see a show of hands. Is there anything you can think of that you would be willing to pay that thief for if you could have it back? I see a few hands. Anybody want to share what that item is? Okay.
My 65-inch TV.
Okay. All right. Okay. I probably need to repeat these so those people watching online. We had a 65-inch TV. The things that were your mom's. Radonna? Our dog. Okay. We know what that's like when he runs off in St. Louis, right? Others? Anybody else want to share what they would be willing to pay a thief for? Maddie? Okay. All right. Say that again, Maddie. Your grandma's with the mask on. I didn't repeat it, Kyler. I can't hear with the mask on. Baby doll. Okay. No. Her grandmother. Okay. Okay. So if she were kidnapped, you'd be willing to pay a ransom, right? All right. Others? Anybody else want to share? See, there are things. Why would you be willing to pay for those things, but you wouldn't be willing to pay for other things? Irreplaceable? What's that? Sentimental? Of more value? I mean, personally? Maybe not monetarily? As we look within Scripture, and I think of John chapter 10, and I don't think it's just talking about Satan, but I think the application can be there, but as well, it talks about simply a situation or something or someone, like a kidnapping, is being stolen. Starting in verse 1, Jesus says, "Truly I tell you, anyone who doesn't enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in some other way, is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens it for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name, and he leads them out. And when he has brought all his own outside, he goes ahead of them. The sheep follow him because they know his voice. They will never follow a stranger. Instead, they will run away from him because they don't know the voice of the strangers." Jesus gave them this figure of speech, but they did not understand what he was telling them. Jesus said again, "Truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep didn't listen to them. I am the gate. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. A thief comes only to steal and to kill and destroy. I have come so that you may have life and have it in abundance." Basically, Jesus is saying, anyone other than me, you need to follow me. This idea of a thief, one that is coming, one who would steal our relationship away from us with God. Satan is called by Jesus the father of lies. He's called a liar, a murderer from the beginning. We think of Adam and Eve, and that's exactly what he did, was he stole that fellowship that they had with the Father. That scene of walking in the cool of the garden, talking with God, was gone because of sin. And yet, We find in passages like 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20, that you are not your own. You are bought with a price. Jesus bought us back. In a passage that's really talking to elders and really having reference to those who would oversee the church. In Acts chapter 20, talking to the elders at Ephesus, in verse 28, Paul says this, and there's quite a bit in the discourse and what he has to say to these men, but he says in verse 28, "Take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers." And then it says, "To feed the church of God which he hath purchased with his own blood." Now let me ask you something. If God owns everything and Jesus is God, why would he have to purchase us? Because we were stolen. We were stolen with sin. Sue's son Mark is working with an organization who are saving people who are in slavery in our world. It's a need, and it's very real. But as real as that is physically, aren't we in that business of saving those who have become slaves of sin? Isn't that what Jesus has left us for? That we do shine a light that can be seen. But he's the only one who can buy them back. He's the only one who could pay the price. We are on our own, are not sinless. We're only sinless because he made us that way. Forgiving us. Why would he do that? Why would he pay a price? Maybe sentimental, Bruce. Maybe irreplaceable. Of great value. In the same way that you probably have some things that you would pay a thief to have back. He did that for you. You are that special item. We're made in his image. What is more special? What is more sentimental? What is of greater value? The praise team wants to come up. A few years ago, I listened to a man that I have a lot of respect for. And very close to the last words he said, was I understand he owns it all. I don't know any better words to end this than he owns it all. That should change our lives.
We offer now a time for if you've this message has moved you in any way that you may come up, we can talk about things. There's always a call to come to Jesus, to talk about the things, to strengthen each other in God's service. Take this time just to offer the opportunity to let you come down. A lot of times I come up here and we talk about all of the outreach programs that we do with the backpacks, with, or which might not happen, with the benevolence programs that we have with feeding the high schoolers and all those things. Those are a large chunk of what we do with the offering that you give us. But another chunk is that we don't talk about very often is the things that being here, our building gets to be used for. And I've got a couple weeks of things that we'll go over that we get to do. But things that we don't talk about all the time. Just this last week, we had a person from Arkansas who was originally from Springfield and probably attended our church in the 60s that had passed away. The husband and the wife moved to Arkansas. Throughout the week, they were going to bury her body here with her husband in Springfield. They don't know anyone in Springfield. It happened in almost 50 years. They were able to call our church and ask us if we had somebody that was able to do a funeral for them, which I got to do, and we were able to offer that service to them. That is part of the offering that God's given to you. Because of that, a person that very few people here, if any, and we're not even sure if she went here, she couldn't remember the name of the church because she was only like three. So even if she came here and she saw the building, she wouldn't remember. We're able to offer and plan and direct a funeral for them, just a graveside service. But it was something that just because of the offering that we give here, we were able to fulfill the need for a family, and there was about 30 of them there, to come together and have that time to bury the body, which is something that we don't talk about very often. It's the things that we are able to do just because of the offering that God gives us to do these things. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you for blessing all of the things that we get to do here in this church and outside of this church. Thank you for blessing the offering that we received today and letting it serve your kingdom here and abroad and all the different things that we get to do. Thank you for this day and the beautiful weather that we've had and the long weekend that we get. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Okay, do we have any announcements as we close today?
I've got one.
Okay.
This Wednesday night, we're going to begin in-person class. It will still be online, but also in person. We're beginning on a study of the Kings, and that was a request. So we'll be studying Kings of Israel and Judah and making application with that as well. So you can either be here online, just contact me if you're not already online on the online class and you would like to be. And we can get you hooked up with that. And then also we'll have the in-person class, and we're hoping that we have a good number for that as well. There will also be a teen class that will be offered, more like an activity night. And we even think there's already some high schoolers that come to breakfast that are already interested in that. So be praying about that as well. We're excited about that. And so that will be starting up as well. So we look forward to being able to begin some of those things again and to offer that. So it's going to be at 7:00 will be the class. Actually, that's a really good question. Should we go earlier? Would it be easier for people? Because we just planned on 7. We're going to leave it at 7 for now. So it will be at 7:00. If we need to change that, we're going to be flexible with that. So it will be at 7:00, and the adult class should be over by 7:45.
The teens same.
Teens would be the same, yeah.
Okay. Any other announcements? Okay. We pray you have a great week. Let Jesus' light shine through you this week.
Sing to the King, is coming to reign. Glories to Jesus, the Lamb that was slain. Life and salvation, His empire will bring. Joy to the nations, when Jesus is King.
soul.